I'm Katie Warner, the Vice President of the League of Women Voters of St. Mary's County and your co-moderator for the evening. Mia Bowers, to my left, the third Vice President of the NAACP, will be my co-moderator for the evening. We are pleased to partner with the St. Mary's chapter of the NAACP, the Center for the Study of Democracy at St. Mary's College in Historic St. Mary's City, and the Lexington Park Library to bring you this forum. You can find more information about the League, the Center for the Study of Democracy, and the NAACP at our information tables, and we ask that you please consider joining each of our organizations. Before we begin, I want to tell you about vote411.org, the League's online voter guide. We hope you'll take advantage of the information available there. You can go to that website, put in your address, and find answers to questions each candidate was given. And if you are not technologically inclined to do so, there is a voter's guide printed here at the library. Some important dates to remember. October 18th is the last day prior to the election to register to vote or to change your party affiliation. You may also register to vote or update your voter registration information in person during early voting or on election day. October 27th through November 3rd is early voting from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. There are three early voting sites this year, the Bay District Firehouse, the Hollywood Firehouse, and the Mechanicsville Firehouse. And November 8th is Election Day. The polls are open from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. Vote by mail drop boxes are now located throughout the county. Ballots are collected at least once a day through Election Day at 8 p.m. If you wish to ask a question, please raise your hand. A runner will bring you an index card, and if you need one, a pencil. Write your question briefly and legibly. Being certain that it's relevant to the candidate seeking the office that is at the table. On the top of the card, write the name of the individual you want to address, or if you wish to ask every candidate, write all. Follow-up questions must also be submitted on cards. When you finish writing, hold up your card, and a runner will collect and take it to our review panel, sitting over there to my left. The review panel will examine each question to be certain it is legible, appropriate to the office the candidate is seeking, civil, and stated politely. Please hold your applause until after all the candidates have answered all the questions and asked of them and made their closing remarks. Tonight you will be addressing the candidates for the following general election races: House of Delegates, Legislative District 29B, County Commissioner District 2, District 4, and District 1. Each candidate will begin with a 3-minute opening statement before you begin questions from the audience. Candidates then have 1 minute to respond to each question asked. When the question period is over, each candidate may make a 2-minute closing statement. Our timer has a computer and will signal the speaker with a yellow card at the 30-second mark and a red stop card when the time is up. The speaker may finish a sentence, but nothing more. Remember, this is a respectful occasion. Please compose your questions in a civil manner and do not express support or opposition for any of the candidates during the forum. Finally, hold your applause until the end of the evening. Thank you. And Mia is going to take the first forum.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you, Katie. Now, on to the candidates for the House of Delegates, Delegate District 29B, Deb Ray and Brian Crosby. Now, we will have each candidate to give their opening remarks. Deb Ray, you're up first.
Oh, thank you. Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm Deb Ray, and I'm humbly asked for your vote to be your delegate for District 29B. First, I would like to thank the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, the Center for Democracy, and the Library for hosting tonight's event. Thank you, Brian, for being here. And thank you to all of you. I appreciate your time and your consideration. I hope you find tonight enlightening. 4 years ago, my role in politics changed. I anticipated my opponent would live up to his self-portrayal as a moderate Democrat, working with Governor Hogan and standing to fight for our community. But 1 year into his term, COVID hit, and government shut down our businesses, our churches, and our schools, and my opponent said nothing. They stomped on our rights, and he sat silently by. So I re-engaged. I also anticipated hearing great news about the Great Mills Road corridor, Great Mills Road and Route 5, since that was one of his keystone issues when he ran for office. Didn't hear anything until this year, when he announced he got some money for it. But SHA just told us on Tuesday the money's not there. I started reviewing his voting record, and I found out he's not a moderate Democrat at all. In fact, he's a far-left radical who voted to neuter our police, making our communities less safe. He voted for taxpayer funding of abortions, for new taxes, and putting taxes on our online education and streaming services, and the indoctrination of our children in schools, basically teaching five-year-olds gender ideology and sexual orientation. The final straw came when my opponent sought to steal our votes when he proposed House Bill 655 and to take us voting for all five of our county commissioners to us just voting for two of our county commissioners. And he did that with no public hearings and no input from any other elected official. That was it. I was all in. I'm running to be your representative in Annapolis, to be your voice, and to fight for you and not against you, to work to remove government roadblocks and infringements on your rights so that you can live the best life. I'm a mother, a wife, a 20-year Air Force veteran who served honorably. I'm a defense contractor and a member of several service organizations such as the Marine Corps League and the Ridge Volunteer Fire Department Auxiliary. Once again, I ask you for your vote.
Thank you, Deb.
And
thank you, Deb.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
I want to echo my opponent's thing.
One second. All right.
I want to thank the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, the library, as well as the Center for Democracy, Deb, and again, all of you for coming out this evening. 4 years ago, when I campaigned, the number one issue for St. Mary's County was that we didn't have a voice in Annapolis. If you go back through all the budgets, there were no discretionary allocation of funds for our county. Nothing outside of, frankly, county commissioner bills, which were a rubber stamp, is all that was getting passed. I can assure you that over the last 4 years, each and every day, I've woken up and we have fought to get resources to St. Mary's County, specifically my district in 29B. We've advanced projects such as the $90 million for the Smart Building, which is the largest state investment put into St. Mary's County since the Thomas Johnson Bridge. $500,000 for the Ridge Volunteer Fire Department, $100,000 for a health department hub here in Lexington Park. We did get $10 million of additional state highway funding for 5 and Great Mills, and we can discuss that a little bit more. But it's a shame that politics has come and played a role in that. But the money is allocated there. Additionally, we got the extra early voting center at the Lexington Park, at Bay District Firehouse, and that is from October 27th to November 3rd. We got $16 million for historic St. Mary City. We got $250,000 for Farming for Hunger to bring a second location. And you can go on with the amount of projects and money that we have gotten allocated to St. Mary's County over the last 4 years. 4 years ago, as a freshman, you know, I was just a brand new delegate. Today, I'm the vice chair of Economic Matters, the first freshman to do so. That is the most powerful committee in Annapolis, and along with my chair, Chair C.T. Wilson from Charles County, you know, Southern Maryland has a very strong voice in how our economy looks over the next 40 years. In the next 4 years, we want to continue to grow the airport to bring in the Office of Naval Research. We additionally We want to continue to work with the Community Development Corps to do projects for revitalization here right along the Great Mills Corridor. And we do want to complete the 5 and Great Mills intersection and ensure that our schools are adequately funded so that your kids get a world-class education to compete at a global level. My whole life has been dedicated to service, from 10 years in the Army, 3 tours to Afghanistan as a U.S. Army Ranger, to a member of your Maryland National Guard, as a contractor who supports the warfighter on Webster Field. I've dedicated my life to service. We've only served one term, and we've accomplished so much, and we want to continue that over the next term. And truly, we've only gotten started. So thank you all so much for coming out.
Thank you, Governor Crosby. Our first question is going to be for both candidates. Dr. Crosby, you want to go first? Could you each discuss your stance on whether or not teachers should carry guns in school as a security measure?
Yeah. Yeah, no, I can't think of a more ludicrous idea in my entire life to arm teachers. And I think that it's appalling and contradictory that my opponent and some on that side don't trust our teachers with a curriculum, but they trust them with an AR-15. That's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. And at a time when we should be celebrating our teachers for the heroes that they are, they didn't bring on the pandemic. They didn't want to close schools. They didn't want to do hybrid learning. No, we shouldn't be attacking them and making up wild conspiracy theories or coming up with ludicrous ideas to prevent school shootings. We should be funding more SROs, and I commend our Board of Education, along with Dr. Smith, for the work they've done. They've had the ballistic wraps, the protective vestibules, and they've done a ton of work. But as your delegate, I want to make clear, we're not funding teachers with any sort of weapon system. We're going to let people who have weapon systems make that their primary focus, and we will rely on our law enforcement for that.
Thank you.
So could you repeat the question, please?
Absolutely. Could you each discuss your stance on whether or not teachers should carry guns in school as a security measure?
So I think that's a great question. We just heard how my opponent feels that guns shouldn't be allowed in school. You know, I'm just opposite of that. And I look at instances like Uvalde, Texas. I know there are parents there, there are teachers there, that if they had the gun, they could have stopped what happened there. So my opponent turned this into now not trusting our teachers. That's far from the truth. We trust our teachers. We believe our teachers can keep our kids safe. So allowing them to have a firearm in the school, we could train them, give them additional training, pay them more to be the security for the school. I absolutely support SROs in the school. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question, actually, Ms. Ray, you're gonna go first on this one.
Yes, ma'am.
What have you done or will do to protect Maryland's environmental future?
No. Thank you. Well, for the environment, I've worked hard. When I was a delegate, I was a member of the DNR's Oyster Advisory Commission, and worked hard with them to identify sanctuary organization or sanctuary locations to rebuild our oyster industry. And I'm a big proponent of aquaculture. I support the St. Mary's River Watershed Association. I'm a member there. I think it's great. Thank you.
Thank you. Crosby?
Thank you. Yeah. I can think of nothing more important for us to live in a clean, pure environment. We have to take care of the only earth that we have. And I can tell you, in my 4 years in Annapolis, a couple bills come to mind. The first was the Clean Energy Jobs Act, which actually brought 800 more solar jobs back to Maryland and grew that economy. Additionally, it brought wind manufacturing here to the state to make us a leader going forward over the next decade in that industry. The second bill that comes to mind is my bill, which had to do with oysters in the bay. But essentially, we provided $5 million of additional funding to go into our bay, specifically the tributaries in the St. Mary's River, which cleans up the inhabitant and makes it better off and more clean because, frankly, it is something that is, you know, vitally important to our economy and tourism, that people can come here, they can enjoy the water that surrounds us on all three sides, and we should be able to make money off of that as a community.
Thank you. This next question is for Deb Ray. Can you explain your voting history in respect to veterans?
Sure. As the only female veteran in the House of Delegates during the term, I took pride in looking at the veterans' bills and supporting them. And now, there are some bills, though, that came forward where people think they were veterans' bills, but in reality, they weren't. You notice politicians tend to use certain groups to tug on our heartstrings, right? So they use veterans as the shiny ploy, especially in an election year, so that they can say, oh, hey, we passed a veterans bill, vote for us, we're pro-veteran. When in reality, some of those veterans bills were about the dead voting, it wasn't about veterans at all, or increasing the cost of college, or this one was the hiring preferences for veterans. That bill did nothing. It was a wasted bill. And, you know, being a veteran, I saw right through that. So that's why I voted against that bill.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. Delegate Crosby, you want to go first? If elected, how will your term differ from your previous term?
Well, certainly it's going to be different in the sense that now I will have an entire 4 years to be the vice chair of a very powerful committee. And I think that that lends itself to bringing back even more resources than we did before, certainly. Additionally, I think it is important that we understand Wes Moore is likely to be the next governor. And when that happens, that will mean it will have a Democratic administration along with Democratic leadership in both the House and the Senate. And regardless of what happens in this seat, that is how it is going to be. And so you need somebody with a seat at the table that can actually stand up and lobby for you here in the county so that somebody has a voice and they take it serious. Because I can tell you, Democrats have a vested interest in how my constituents feel. They listen when we talk. I assure you. So that has led to significant investment into our community. And that's without the Democratic governor. That's with a Republican governor who we've worked with. So I look forward to continuing that in the next term.
Thank you.
Can you repeat the question, please?
Absolutely. If elected, how would your term differ from your previous term?
Well, some of the things I'm going to keep consistent from my previous term is the town hall meetings that I have with constituents. In fact, I will increase my constituent outreach. If you pick up my palm card in the back, everybody can have my phone number and my email. And that's direct phone to my phone, not to my staffer. So I'll return constituent services to be the number one part of being a delegate. And like the last time, I will not compromise my morals and my ethics. Just to get something. You know, somebody told me the other day I had to compromise to get along, and that's not true. I have worked across the aisle to get bills passed and to get things for the county and to do good things for the state. So I will continue on that road. I will not spend your money needlessly, like having an office where I'm never there and just having the air conditioner having the air conditioner cool the furniture. Thank you.
Thank you. This question is for both candidates. Delegate Crosby, you're first. What is your stance on women's reproductive rights?
Yep. So I trust women to make decisions about their health care, and I trust doctors to provide solid medical advice when it comes to that. And I don't think, frankly, in the home of religious freedom, that we should be imposing our religious beliefs on someone else to make their decision. These are extraordinarily difficult, challenging times for some of these women. And it is unfortunate, but it's their decision and their choice to make. And I respect that. And as your delegate, I will always respect that. The second thing I would say is I'm not so sure my opponent or her party were ready for the post-Roe v. Wade world. I really don't. And I don't know how you can look at kids that are 10 years old in certain states that are being forced to carry, you know, their rapist pregnancy all the way to term. Or a woman who ends up having something extraordinarily devastating in terms of news, you know, in the last trimester to have to go through with it. And I just really respect women in that difficult time.
Thank you. This next question is for...
I thought that was for me, too.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So obviously this question is about abortion. Because first of all, I'm all for women's reproductive rights. I'm a woman. I don't care how you reproduce. You know, do it the normal way. Get it in vitro. Whatever you want to reproduce, go for it. I think that's awesome. But when it comes to abortion, my morals and my beliefs tell me abortion is murder and that's wrong. And I cannot believe my government wants us to be complicit in that and want us to pay for abortions. My opponent's okay with it. You know, he voted for a $3.5 million bill to teach more people to commit abortions. You know, and he's talking to you about the 10-year-old. Well, there was an amendment to the bill that said, hey, let's you know, abortions up after 24 weeks, right? Well, he didn't vote for that amendment. He said, no, I want to do abortions up until birth and after. Thank you.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. And Deborah, you're going to go first. As we have seen in Florida, places with long coastlines and low-lying areas are particularly vulnerable to climate change. How will you help move Maryland and St. Mary's County to a more sustainable future?
Well, you know, that's a great question. And I guess what we're talking here is green energy. So I'm all for green energy. I think, you know, smart people, like say like Elon Musk, creates a solar panel or solar power tiles we can put on our roofs to bring energy into the home and power it. I think that's fantastic. But my opponent here wants us to drive electric cars, wants everything to run on electricity and get rid of gasoline in the state. Have you priced out an electric car? $60,000. And then, if you haven't, price them out, then watch Wham Bam Tesla Cannon. They talk to you and tell you about after an accident, how much it costs to repair it. I think what we are doing, we're denying ourselves the use of cheap energy because of an ideology, and that's to the detriment of our citizens. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm a little confused about what is going on right now, but abortion after somebody is born is called murder, and that's not being repealed.
That's what you voted for.
But that's beside the point. Moving on to the question about green energy, yeah, I think that we need to continue to invest in green technology, and we need to lure those jobs here to St. Mary's County, because whether you agree with it or disagree with it, this is somewhat the energy market of the future. And so if we don't get ahead of it, we're not going to have those jobs, and we're going to lose out on real economic opportunity. Another step that we could take is partnering with Calvert County to continue the expansion of the nuclear power plant. And, you know, we could use some real technology like they use in France, where we harness the waste and use that for further energy development to put us on a path to a more cleaner, sustainable future.
Thank you. Don't go anywhere. This next question is for you. Delegate Crosby, you state that teachers didn't want to close schools. Will you state if you believe closing schools was a mistake, or would you follow the same path?
No, I think that that is a decision for the health department in partnership with the Board of Education and Scott Smith. And that is who the proper decision or authority to make that, or who has the proper decision making and authority to make that decision for your kids. Nobody wants your kids to stay at home. I understand how challenging that is. But obviously you're in the middle of a pandemic, and so there are measures, especially when you're at the beginning of it, and it's dynamic, and you don't know a lot of things, and you're trying to make decisions to protect your people. That's all that was happening. So I trust Scott Smith, the Board of Education, along with our health department, to make the best decision for our citizens to keep us safe through the pandemic.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. Deborah, you're gonna go first. Delegate Crosby was the lead sponsor on HB 655, and he insinuated that our county was racist while promoting the bill that reduced our ability to vote for all five county commissioners. What's your stance on HB 655?
I don't even know why I'm looking for my notes on this one, but I was against it. I couldn't believe he offered it. Right now, every person in this county that votes gets five votes for county commissioner. Doesn't matter who you are, what your creed is, what you look like. If you're a voter, you get five votes. Nobody's disenfranchised. He said it violated the Voting Rights Act. But yet then he didn't put it in the next year to try and correct it. He held no county hearings on this. I think you all remember back in 2015 when the county commissioners proposed changing to go to Code Home Rule and how upset people were about that. Yeah, so this was just a reiteration of that. If you want to change something, talk to us. Have hearings. Tell us what's going on and why we should do it. I think the biggest issue, though, is Mr. Crosby forgets he's in the legislative branch and the county commissioners are part of the executive branch. And
thank
we
you.
All get to vote.
Thank you.
I'm not done with the sentence. We all get to vote
no.
for
thank
our
you,
executive branch representatives.
So we have a commission form of government, which basically means our county commissioners need to go to Annapolis to get approval. But what I would just say to this is, you know, all that we proposed is that you should have the ability, as citizens, to elect somebody who can then advocate for you at any level of government. And if you think about it, that's exactly how we vote for Congress and for this seat, 29B. The voters from 29B elect myself or my opponent, and we go up and advocate on behalf of this district to bring resources back to this district. Nobody's calling anybody a racist. Nobody's slighting anybody. We gave a short history on the Voting Rights Act, but that was it. And all I can tell you is, if I gave you this example, it would be like Marylanders or Virginians getting a say to vote on who Maryland's governor is. That's ridiculous. Nobody would think that was okay. And so as your delegate, yeah, I'm going to continue to advocate that at every level of government, you should have the choice of who represents and advocates for you at each and every level.
Thank you. Deb Ray, this question is for you. Do you support dog fighting in Maryland?
No, I don't. And that was not the bill. The bill was about the dog fighting tools. And I used it to make a point. And an hour later, I voted for the exact same bill that came through. It was the Senate version, and I voted for that one. Yeah. No, I love animals. You should see my two dogs. It is fun to watch them play together. You might think they're fighting, but they're really just playing together. So I can admit to my bad votes, but Brian, can you admit to yours? Can you admit to that you made a bad vote when you voted for $65 million tax credit for illegal aliens? How about for the $2.2 billion school construction program that guaranteed $0 for St. Mary's County? Or how about the gender indoctrination of five-year-olds? Can you admit to those bad votes, Brian? Thank you.
Thank you. Delegate Crosby, this next question is for you. Can you elaborate on the Route 5 construction funding Do we have it?
Yeah, so it is slated for construction. Obviously, it is a little bit further than I would have liked, and it has been a battle with the current administration, you know, to get that funding moved up. Last session, we allocated an additional $10 million pre-authorization for the next budget. And State Highway is interpreting that to mean as long as they can possibly use it, which is like 20 year 25, 26, and 27. Next year, we are going to put a timestamp on that funding so that it begins the following year. And working with an all-Democratic legislation or all-Democratic branches of government, which is likely to happen, I'm going to have a seat at the table to ensure that that happens. So I promise you, I will continue to fight for this intersection because I have to travel this horror show each and every day. It's a nightmare. I get it. I feel the pain. I go through it every day when I work at Webster Field. And I can just tell you, I'm obsessed with that little strip of State Highway or State Highways project.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. Please explain how you help fund St. Mary's County Public Schools. Delegate Crosby, you're first.
Yeah, so actually we can talk a little bit about what my opponent just brought up. I would say it's two things. First off, your students, your children are at the forefront of my mind each and every day that I'm up there. I voted for the Blueprint of Maryland, which was a once-in-a-generational opportunity to fund our schools. It brought $11.6 million of additional state funds to our county. Additionally, that funding follows the student, which means me in 29B, where we have pockets of density, there is more funding allocated to our students here in the district. The second, the school construction bill, yeah, my opponent is right. Not up front, there was no money allocated to St. Mary's. However, the benefit to the bill and why Republican counties across the state supported it is because it funded the engineering for a brand new school. That is what is allocated in that bill. And so St. Mary's and rural counties benefit from that because that is a huge cost up front that we've mitigated now through that piece of legislation.
Thank you.
Funding for St. Mary's County Schools, right?
Yes.
Okay, well, in 2015, our team was notified we received the funding for the Higher Education Center, the SMART building, $78.7 million. So I'm really happy we were able to help bring the University of Maryland here to St. Mary's County. You know, that was just a continuation of the team that was before us. So, the $2.2 billion school construction bill that he thinks you should be okay with, that guaranteed $0 for St. Mary's. 88% of that money went to only six jurisdictions. Montgomery County, Baltimore City, you know, basically the counties along the Route 95 corridor. Maybe that's why Montgomery County just held a fundraiser for him, because he seems to vote more for Montgomery County than he does for St. Mary's schools. Or for St. Mary's. Thank you.
Thank you. Delegate Crosby, you said you were on the most powerful committee in Annapolis, which happens to be the one in charge of utility rates. Why are our utility rates constantly going up? Everyone say calm.
You good? Yeah, I just want to clear something up. First off, my opponent while in office, was the only delegate to vote against all or part of every single solitary budget while she was in. The Republican governor's budget, which on average gives about $100 million to St. Mary's County for education. Second, the Smart Building, which is a roughly about $90 million. If she got it in 2015, why wasn't it built until 2020? So we got that money. And that's just the way it is gone. And to be honest with you, you know, it was stripped out because we couldn't find any compromise and we wouldn't work with anybody while we were up there. Now the price, or excuse me, the question was about commodity prices or prices of electricity, and frankly it's because it's tied to the commodity. And the PSC sets your rate. Every rate that SMETCO puts in has to be approved by the Public Service Commission, which former delegate Tony O'Donnell now sits on, and they have to get approved. And that is tied to the price of the commodity, and when oil is up, it's going to cost more.
Thank you. This question is for both candidates. What are the three greatest issues in Maryland to be addressed? Deborah, you can go first.
Thank you. Well, when I go door knocking, I hear it's the same things. It's crime, education, and taxes. So those would be the issues that I definitely work on. But let's talk about this budget thing again. So I hold a letter here from the budget management. We did get the money for that smart building. I don't vote for the budget because they use our money to pay for abortions. Everybody has a line. Don't you have a line somewhere, something that you hold dear and believe, and that you will not cross it? Well, that one's mine. I believe a woman carrying a child is a great thing. And I don't want my taxpayer money, I don't want your taxpayer money going to fund that. So, thank you.
Thank you. The question, what are the three greatest issues in Maryland to be addressed?
Yeah, I think it mirrors the district, and frankly, you've all heard it. Maryland is a microcosm of the United States, and frankly, 29B, the most competitive seat in the entire state, is a microcosm of Maryland. And I truly believe that it's economic diversity. We need to diversify our economy from the federal government. In our instance, it's Pax River, so that we can augment the industry that runs off it. We need to continue to invest in education so that we have world-class schools, so that your kids can go out there and compete on a global economy. And lastly, it's infrastructure projects. We need to continue to invest in our infrastructure so that we have top-notch transportation and that we connect our communities so that our industry can thrive. And as your delegate, I'm going to continue to put those at the forefront of my platform and each and every day when I lobby for you in Annapolis.
Thank you. This will be the final question before your closing remarks. Delegate Crosby, you're going to go first. What is the one issue your opponent is misstating? Explain.
She got a pretty good handout she's giving out with all sorts of misinformation. I think it's that I continue to just vote with the majority party. And that is not the truth. I've opposed every single tax that has come up there, to include the 21st economy digital ad tax. I didn't support that. Because I recognize in this district that things are a little bit tougher. And we don't feel like we got the same return to our dollar that we do, that maybe a Prince George's or a Baltimore City or a Montgomery County feels. So I've fought hard against my own party to make sure that we have kept your taxes low and that you see a better return on your dollar from your state government. And any other statement is just factually inaccurate and it's false. Why I got 10 seconds? We're not indoctrinating any kids either. That's just completely made up. I don't know what all this is to do is to rile people up, and it's just false and a lie.
Thank you.
Well, I wasn't sure what to say. First of all, I apologize if I got your record wrong. I will have to go back and recheck that. But he just said we're not indoctrinating kids. I don't know who he's talking to, but I know when I go door knocking and I talk to the parents, they come to the door and they tell me different things. Our kids are definitely being indoctrinated. I had a parent tell me that their child can no longer refer to them as mom and dad. that they are now the adult in their life. Like, wait a minute, what's going on there? You know, we have, we're being told about kids. I mean, T-Bone and Heather just had this on the other day, right? Kids are being taken in to a private room with their teacher and a counselor and said, what pronoun would you like to be referred to? So no, it is going on in the schools and we shouldn't be turning a blind eye to it. As far as school goes, I fully support the tax dollar following the child. So it's the parent that's in charge of the education. And when the schools close, they can find the right education for their child to be successful. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we will give each candidate their closing remarks. Delegate Crosby.
Again, I want to thank the League of Women Voters, NAACP, Center for Democracy, for hosting this forum this evening in the library. And I want to thank all of you for coming out. It means the absolute world to me to see so many people participating, and to my wife and kid who are watching at home. 4 years ago, the number one issue was that we did not have a voice in Annapolis. We've restored that. We've worked hard each and every day across the aisle to bring back resources for you all. There was no discretionary money allocated for our county, yet alone my district, and we've changed that. And I've talked through the numerous projects that we got funded. We shouldn't turn back the clock. We shouldn't go back to the old way of just not working with anybody, voting against everything, and getting nothing in return for our citizens. That's not the way government works. It's just not. I gave the example of a jug of water. We pay for a bottle of water, a dollar. They give me the bottle of water back. We weren't getting that before, and today we are. And it's been nice to see projects started in our community. It's tough to be in the middle. I'll admit, I get hit from both sides. Democrats sometimes want me to go further. Republicans obviously aren't happy that I'm not on their side. But I've held the middle ground, and I've worked with everybody, to include our state senator, to ensure that you got your due. My whole life has been dedicated to service, as I said from the start. You know, 10 years in the Army, 5 on active duty, 5 on with your Maryland National Guard, you know, 3 deployments to Afghanistan. I currently work on Webster Field supporting the warfighter, so I'm a member and an active participant in this community to which I represent. This is my part-time job, and I take it very seriously, but it is service. And truly, we have only gotten started, and I'm asking you for another 40 years by humbly asking for your vote. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Is that right?
Once again, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, and the Center for Democracy, and the library for hosting tonight's event. I hope you're now able to see the difference between the two of us sitting in front of you. We each fight for a vision of Maryland, but it's very different from each other. I fight for a Maryland where government protects our rights and refuses to use the heavy hand to control everything we do and think. A Maryland where your health freedom aren't forced to decide between an experimental vaccine, a job, or your education. Maryland, where healthcare professionals and politicians respect the sanctity of life, and taxpayers aren't forced to fund abortions. Maryland, where you choose your child's education, and you know and approve the curriculum and the resources that are being used to provide that education. A Maryland, where you aren't overly concerned about your daughter or son coming home after a night of work, and where you can go to the park or out for dinner or to the local carnival without fear of crime. A Maryland where we can trust our law enforcement, where they trust us, and where we have a court system that dispenses equal justice under the law. A Maryland where you can afford gas, groceries, utilities, a vacation, and to retire. A Maryland where we build up individuals, families, and communities to succeed and achieve their dreams. My vision of Maryland is simple. It's a beautiful place where you love where you live and you can live your best life. With your support and vote, I'm ready to take back the responsibility of being delegate for District 29B and to fight for our vision of Maryland. I humbly ask for your vote and to stand with me in the fight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can we now have the candidates for County Commissioner District 2 come to the table?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mike Hewitt. For the past 60 years, I've lived in St. Mary's County. And for the past 43 years, I've lived in Hollywood with my wife, Elaine. We have two grown children, Matthew and Christina, and six grandchildren. Our son, Matthew, and his wife, Kelsey, live in Bel Air with our grandchildren, Sloan Michelle, Colin Matthew, and Lynn and Elaine. Our daughter Christina lives with her husband Nathan in St. Mary's County in Hollywood with our granddaughters, Maddie Rose, Eva Grace, and Charlotte Marie. My son Matthew has a PhD in biophysics and human anatomy, and he's the director of gene therapy for Charles Rivers Laboratories based in Boston, Massachusetts. My daughter Christina has a dual major, and she works as a program manager at IMAS Pax River. My wife and I retired in 2017 after 38 years of running a small business, Hewitt's Service Center, in California, Maryland. It was a business my father started February 1st, 1964 in Bushwick, later moved to the corner of Chances Run Road and 235 in California, and later down to the Esperanza Shopping Center until we closed in 2017. It was while working a small business that we grew to understand the value of hard work, of good decision making, and keeping realistic goals. Our hard work has paid off for us and has allowed me to enter into public service in St. Mary's County. I've been a county commissioner for the past 8 years and about 9 months. I've also been the Governor Hogan's appointee to the Critical Areas Commission of Maryland for the same period of time. My previous public experience includes 5 years on the Zoning Board of Appeals, 4 years on the Board of Education, a little over a year on the Planning Commission, 4 years on the Patuxent River Commission as Governor Hogan's appointee again. And prior to the Planning Commission, I served on the Budget Advisory Committee to the Board of Education for several years. Prior to that, I was also on the State Route 235 Maryland Focus Group, and I was Delegate John Slade's appointee there. If reelected, I will continue to focus on lower taxes and more efficient government. The needs of our residents will be primary in my mind. And on the campaign trail, I look forward to seeing you in the stores and in the streets. My goal will be to provide the best service to the residents of this county to the best of my abilities.
Thank you. Mr. Russell?
Right. Thank you. Good evening. Thank you to the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, Center for Study of Democracy, and St. Mary's County Library for hosting us tonight. Thank you to all of you for being here to make an informed choice and learn about your candidates, and to everyone watching at home, and to our moderators and the timekeeper for making sure we shut up one time. My name is Brandon Russell, and I'm running for St. Mary's County Commissioner in District 2, which is the Leonardtown-Hollywood area. I have deep roots in this county. I was born and raised here. My family has a farm in Clements where I spent summers out of school learning the value of hard work and determination to go after what you want. I'm a Choptacon graduate, and after I graduated, I paid my way through college to earn my bachelor's degree in English. It took me a little bit longer than the normal four-year program, but I'm proud that I was able to complete it. I have a career spent in management and operations, where I've led diverse teams of people to produce stellar results on making things more efficient. I became involved in local politics over the last few years because I noticed a trend of our commissioners making decisions that did not represent the will of the people, and I intend to change that. Over the last few years, I've been very active. In fact, last year, I led efforts to fight for a fair and balanced redistricting process for our county commissioner and board of education districts. I stood with the sheriff's office employees, educators, and with the EMS personnel last year during the budget process when they were pushing the commissioners to provide pay parity for them. I attended Citizens Academy last year to learn more about how our local government operates, and while on the campaign trail, I've met with each department director and the directors of some outside agencies to learn how we can better work together when I'm elected. I intend to bring a proactive, solution-oriented mindset to the Board of County Commissioners, and I'm going to do that using my HELP plan, H-E-L-P. It stands for Healthcare, Education, Land Use, and Public Safety. For healthcare, I want to make sure we have healthcare access for everyone so our residents are not having to drive to D.C., Baltimore, Annapolis on a regular basis. Education, making sure that our educators are paid what they're worth and they feel valued, that they can provide a top-class education for our students. Land use, making sure development is targeted so that we don't have commercial facilities in residential areas. And finally, public safety, making sure that our sheriff's office employees are valued, that they're paid what they're worth, and that they can afford to live in the area where they work. I look forward to your questions, and I hope after tonight I have been able to earn your vote. Thank you.
First question is going to be for Mr. Russell. What boards or commissions have you been a member of? Any at St. Mary's County?
Currently, I am a member of the Democratic Central Committee, and as a part of my position there, I have been appointed to the Rural County Committee for the Maryland State Democratic Party to make sure that we have a voice that's active to represent our needs and what we're looking for from the state government and the state party. I have also been very active, as I mentioned, following the redistricting board process. There was only five members that on that board, a five-member board appointed all Republicans by all Republican county commissioners, so we didn't have a fair shot there. So I just kind of consider myself the sixth member of that board and followed along and put in my information where necessary when I could offer an opinion. Thank you.
The next question will be for Commissioner Hewitt. How much taxpayer money just went to BrazeLine to install internet? Who now owns these lines?
I'm not sure I understand the question, but let me say this. We've dumped millions into broadband. And just recently, we had more American Rescue stimulus money provided to us. $3.5 million of that 3.8 was allocated to more broadband. Now, what we have is 98% coverage of the Board of Education children who are in schools. We have the county covered to 97%. Now, there might be some people who say that's not good enough. And for those who don't have it, it probably isn't. But understand something, where we are right now is going to cost us between $20,000 and $25,000 per household to hook them up to broadband. It's important we get there. Now, as far as internet, I guess I'm not sure what that meant, but I'll say to you this, it's public. What we have out there is a public difference.
The next question is for Mr. Russell. What is your opinion on the Royal Farms development in Lexington Park?
Well, I've been pretty outspoken about how I feel about that. First, let me say that I do believe that property rights are important and that we should be able to do with our property what we want within the law, obviously. But when we have an absentee landlord who doesn't really have a direct stake in what happens with that property, I think it's incumbent upon the residents and the county government to advocate for the type of business we want there. Do we want a Royal Farms that is going to be a third gas station and make three gas stations in front of each base gate that sells not very nutritious food in a food desert? Or would we rather have a local small business that is thriving and has thrived through the pandemic? In addition to that, even, you know, explore the arts park nearby, and we have monuments nearby. So I'm against the Royal Farms development, and I'm disappointed that it's going forward.
The next question is for Commissioner Hewitt. On your watch, a 50,000 square foot marijuana facility was built in the county's critical area without benefit of a public hearing or any public scrutiny before first shovel broke ground. Although it can be said it was done legally, many believe you failed to do the right thing by the neighbors and county residents to make sure they knew what was happening in their backyards. In August, you voted no for independent process review. How will you bring residents into the process?
Well, let's start at the end. The way we're going to bring residents into the process is we've recently passed an amendment that any more of these types of facilities have to be in areas with zoned industrial or commercial. They cannot go in the residential areas. Now, as far as what happened with this particular one, our zoning director, our director of land use and growth management, made that decision without consulting the commissioners. Now understand something, in our comprehensive plan, we gave him that authority. But it's kind of like we expected, this commissioner expected him to come to us and say, this is what's going on out there. What do you think? That didn't happen. He was influenced by the commissioner from that district. And he was told that all the other commissioners agreed to it, and we did not. I opposed it, we stopped it, it cannot go any further.
This question is for both candidates, and we'll start with Mr. Russell. What is more important, property rights or the public welfare?
Well, I think that depends on the situation. If it's in reference to Linda's in Lexington Park, I do think that the public welfare should be heavily weighed against property rights, especially because we have an absentee landlord that owns that property. But I want to take a minute and go back to the cannabis question my opponent was asked, because I feel like that's a really big deal. That we had a commercial development happen in a residential area, in the critical area boundary, when my opponent sits on the critical area commission. In fact, he even voted against a pedestrian bike pathway and walkway that St. Mary's College of Maryland wanted to put in. But I reviewed all the minutes from the critical area commission, and there was no talk about this cannabis facility, and I just find that extremely odd. I'm glad they passed the ordinance that would make this not happen again, but it was too little too late. Those residents are already affected. We need forward thinking and proactive actions to make sure that that type of stuff does not happen again.
Commissioner Hewitt?
The question was property rights over public welfare. Obviously, public welfare trumps everything. You cannot have someone on their property burning tires, or have a meth lab, or have something going on that property that influences the safety of the people around it. That's hands down. Public welfare trumps property rights. But when property rights comes to somebody owns something and is doing what's allowed by the law, doing it lawfully and also within the rules, then they should be allowed to do that. I firmly believe the government has no say in what I do in the four walls of my home. If I'm not hurting anybody, if I'm not endangering anybody, what we do in our homes is ours to do as we want.
This one is for both candidates. We'll start with Mr. Russell. Do you think and would you support the requirement that county commissioners live in the area they represent except for the at-large commissioner?
Well, that is already county code. For county commissioners who are running in districts 1, 2, 3, or 4, they have to be a resident of that district and registered to vote. I don't see any issue with that. In fact, I think being a resident of the district should make you better able to advocate for your district. That's why your district should be able to elect you to that office. So it just makes sense to have it done that way.
Commissioner Hewitt?
It does make sense that if you're going to run from a district, you should live in that district. I've probably lived in Leonardtown Hollywood District for 43 years. I'm glad to represent. What I'll say is I would not oppose if somebody wanted to go to, if the public went to a run by district, hey, it'd be a whole lot easier to run in your district instead of having to go all over the county. But look, what's really important to keep in mind is the decisions we make as commissioners impact everyone who lives in St. Mary's County. So it's very important that for people who believe they're being impacted, they need to be able to reach out to any one of the commissioners. Their particular commissioner who represents their district may not always have their ear, may not always be the person they want to hear from. So they need to have a choice in who they can reach out to.
This is a question for all or both commissioners, and we're going to start with Commissioner Hewitt. Can you talk about your support of more affordable housing in St. Mary's? If you don't think it's an issue, why?
This is a big issue. This is a big problem in St. Mary's County. Everybody knows inflation is going crazy. And one of the things that's gone crazy with it is rents. Now, what we have to understand is when you have a shortage of housing, you got to make it up somehow. Now, the way you were able to get affordable housing is you have to increase density. And by increasing density, it means townhomes, it means apartments, it means condos. It means development where you have water and sewer. Sewer that supports the affluent, water that can be provided without impacting our environment. I hate to use the term smart growth. That's a term coined before. But I'll say this. If you're going to get lower rates on rents or ownership, condos, townhouses, you need to be able to have more of them packed into an area. That's not everybody's choice, but that's reality.
Mr. Russell?
So I'm a big supporter of affordable housing, but I think we need to define what affordable housing means to us and to each individual person, because that's going to be very different. In terms of supporting affordable housing in the county, we have a lack of it. Our first year educators, first year public safety officers can barely afford to live in this county, even though they're employed here, and that's just wrong. I think that we need to look at our zoning ordinances and consider putting in some sort of stipulation that says a certain percentage of new construction needs to be affordable housing. And it can't just be focused in one area. It needs to be available throughout our county. In terms of density and smart growth, like Mr. Hewitt was talking about, we just had the Planning Commission approve a new luxury apartment complex up by FDR in St. Andrews. That certainly is not affordable housing. So we can have density, but that doesn't mean it's going to be affordable for people to actually live there.
This is for both candidates. We'll start with Commissioner Hewitt. Is being commissioner a part-time job?
Short answer to that is yes. Look, I came from small business. I worked 6-7 days a week. That was a full-time job. Many of you go to work every day, and you go there at 8, and you stay till 4 or 5, or whatever time when you get off. Those are full-time jobs, 40 hours a week. We're required as commissioners to attend 40 meetings a year. That is a requirement. Now, when we have a budget hearing, that's a meeting. So, honestly, we meet on Tuesdays. But now, the long answer to the question, though, is what you make of it. You can make it a 40-hour, 60-hour, whatever hour a week job you want. The key is, can you be effective? And to be effective, you have to be knowledgeable. You have to have served on boards of education, or planning commissions, or zoning boards of appeals. You have to have gotten out there and understand what's important.
Mr. Russell.
I don't believe that being a commissioner is a part-time job. I believe it is a full-time job. My belief comes from the fact that, yes, by policy, commissioners may only have to attend 40 meetings, but that doesn't mean that you stop responding to constituents when you're not at the meeting. You can have town halls. You can go to where people are, meet them where they're located, learn about what they want, listen to their concerns, and put in the time and effort to make it a full-time job. Mr. Hewitt has said on record, not just here, but in the past, that he believes that being a commissioner is a part-time job. I have a full-time job Monday through Friday, 8 to 4, 40 hours a week. But if I'm elected, when I'm elected commissioner, that's gonna be my second full-time job. I can balance both.
This question is for both candidates. We'll start with Commissioner Hewitt. Do you support maintaining a large fund balance?
The answer is no. What I do support is our policy, which is 15%. Now, what that's supposed to mean for most people in this room is if you have a household, you have an income, you need to have emergency reserves. In case something hits you that's unexpected, whether it be a health emergency or anything that could come along, a hurricane or something, and that you can get by. Now, the golden rule is a year's, but that's your reserves is not reasonable. But what we keep is a policy of 15%. Now, I do believe we should keep reserves, but we should not keep above what we need. We either need to give it back in tax abatements to those, whether it be property tax or income tax, to those who gave it, or give it amenities, whether it be libraries or senior centers or museums or food banks. Things that help the economy.
Mr. Russell?
I do support keeping a fund balance if it makes sense to make sure that we have the money available to respond to the needs that may arise in an emergency. I understand that the policy is 15%. Okay. But in the past, Mr. Hewitt has advocated for increasing that to 20%. And when we talk about having money on hand in case of an emergency, most people don't even have 6 months worth of savings to get through an emergency if it pops up. And I think, based on the information and the feedback that I've heard while I've been out campaigning, most people believe that having a $30 million fund balance when our county is severely lacking in services like mental health, youth activities, some of these other things, is really ridiculous. So there are ways that we can potentially look at spending a fund balance, but also keeping the fund balance that we need to ensure that we have money available to respond to emergencies.
Okay, this question is for Commissioner Hewitt. What have you done to expedite the Route 5 expansion project in Leonardtown?
Well, as many people know, Route 5 is Maryland Route 5. And Maryland Route 5 is controlled by the State Highway Administration. And I'll be honest with you, they are not our friends. They show up, they talk a good game, but they do not want to accelerate that program. They'll talk about they're building it while it's being used and it takes longer. It is taking way too long. But that issue is really sits in the way of, well, in the way. It is a responsibility of our state senators, our state delegates. We heard Delegate Crosby talk about the great, you know, time he has up there and all he's done. Look, like we saw at Route 5 and what we saw with what's going on in Leonardtown, what's going on down there at Great Mills, it's just taken way too long. But it's the state highway, and they're very hard to move.
This question is for both candidates. We'll start with Mr. Russell. What will you do to increase affordable housing options in the community?
So I talked about this a little bit before. I think we need to explore zoning ordinance updates that would regulate affordable housing to a certain percentage of new construction for residential units, and to make sure that we locate that affordable housing throughout the county and not just in a certain area, because everybody needs to be able to have access to that. I want to go back to the Route 5 project for a minute, because that has taken way too long. And as somebody who drives through that area every day, it's very frustrating when they shut down the road and the hospital's there, there's new developments there, housing developments, I should say. It's just a nightmare. And for me, I feel like if we want that to get done, the squeaky wheel's gonna get the grease. So we need to be talking to State Highway, talking to our delegates every day, every hour if it takes it. My opponent has stated at past commissioner meeting that he sat on the phone on hold with Atlantic Broadband for 2 hours. If he can do that, he could have been on the phone to expedite this project.
Commissioner Hewitt?
I think the question was about affordable housing in the community, and Lord knows we need it. Now, what it all gets down to is business. People who build these houses, the government's not building them. Usually it's independent people coming in. Now, what we've been able to do, though, is we've been able to reach pilot programs, payment in lieu of taxes, with people who want to redevelop Fox Chase, who want to redevelop Queen Anne Apartments, who want to redevelop existing areas where we have lower rents. And what we do by giving them those tax breaks is we allow them to continue those lower rents, lower than market rates. Now, I don't want to talk about what my opponent talks about. He likes to talk about what I talk about. But you have to have experience in this job. You have to understand what will work.
This question is for both candidates. We'll start with Mr. Russell. Many frontline medical staff, nurses, doctors, EMS, have battled fatigue treating COVID for years. What plans for supplementing mental health for first responders?
Well, we actually in St. Mary's County have been identified as a mental health desert. We've had over 6,100 mental health visits to the ER in just a year, which is double the state threshold or the state goal, if you want to call it that, for mental health visits. So we need to attract providers to this area. One of the ways we're going to do that is affordable housing, but we also could look at potentially providing incentives for providers to come here and open a practice and stay here and practice and provide those services for a certain number of years. So I'm talking about things like maybe loan repayment programs where a provider could come and agree to serve or to operate a practice for a certain number of years, 5 years, let's say, in exchange for a certain number, monetary value to repay their loan that they would get every year. We need innovative solutions like that to make sure that we attract services that our residents need.
Commissioner Hewitt.
COVID impacted all of us. Did it impact our mental health people, our nurses, our doctors? Absolutely. Now, what we did just recently is we cut the ribbon for the hub down here on Great Mills Road. But that did, the county put $2.4 million into that program. What we're going to be able to do is locate that facility with the nurses and the professionals needed in the area where it's needed. It's no secret that St. Mary's has its share and that Lexington Park has probably more than its share. And it's where we need to focus our efforts, and we have. Now, we also want to talk about how we attract them. Well, you know, people know the Shells, the Bean Building. It is a wonderful facility that's come to our area. We're very lucky to have that kind of thing here. Also, MedStar St. Mary's, another big, big facility that's come here, and it's been a boon to us.
Next question is for both candidates, and we'll start with Mr. Russell. Last year, the commissioners ignored citizen input for a demographically representative redistricting board, whose map is with us for 10 years, and instead appointed members that were all white, all Republicans, four men and one woman. What would you do differently to avoid the chair's altercations with county attorney and gerrymandering of the commissioner and board of education districts?
Well, as you may know, I followed the redistricting process very closely last year, and I guess I could say I was honored to have the chair mention my name in one of his more fiery speeches. But I think that it comes down to the people making the decisions. We had a board of five Republican commissioners who appointed a board of five Republican redistricting members. And that was despite public feedback that was given to them that we wanted a demographically diverse, representative redistricting board. So, like I said, it comes down to the people making the decisions. I actually am an advocate for making a standardized redistricting process, maybe even across the state, but certainly we could do it in our own county, where we lay out who is supposed to serve on the redistricting board. For example, it should be made up of two Republicans, two Democrats, and one independent, to make sure that we have a representation on the redistricting board every 10 years.
The redistricting committee, it was put up to the commissioners to appoint the members. I first appointed an African-American female, Linda Limas, a woman I worked closely with on Feed St. Mary's Food Bank. But we had an issue last year with the census and with the pandemic and everything being crowded into a very tight schedule. Dr. Limas wasn't able to do that because she had just taken on the governorship of the Rotary District for the district. So she passed, and I appointed Dr. Patricia Richardson. Now, Dr. Richardson was the superintendent of schools for quite a while, and back in 1996 was hired by that board, which I was a member. And I'm intimately familiar with her and her knowledge of the demographics of St. Mary's County. Now, I had mine, I picked mine, and that's the way it went. Now, I do not recommend we go that way or change that going forward.
This question is for both candidates, and we'll start with Mr. Russell. Do you think the sheriff, state's attorney, and other court positions should be nonpartisan?
Yes, I do. The sheriff, state's attorney, and court positions don't just serve the Republican Party or the Democrat Party, depending on who is serving in that role at a given time. They serve the entire population of St. Mary's County. I don't understand why that is a partisan race. It doesn't make much sense to me, because oftentimes in nonpartisan races, you can kind of tell where people lie anyway. But I do think that it would go more, it would go more towards promoting an environment where people feel that they are represented and protected by those offices and their office holders, just because they would not have a certain party registration behind their name.
Commissioner Hewitt?
The sheriff, state's attorney, board of education, many others, several others, these are elected officials who have their own constituencies. As commissioners have own constituencies, these people have their ideas on how best to run those departments, how best to handle crime if you're the sheriff, how best to prosecute crime if you're the state's attorney. then it's very important that we as citizens have the opportunity to say, you're not hard enough on crime. We want somebody else. You're not cleaning up gun violence in Lexington Park. We want somebody else. And by having, whether it be Democrats, Republicans, or just people who are non-affiliated run, because you can run as an independent. But it's important to understand that these offices, Board of Education, there's another big one, they have their own constituencies.
Okay, this will be the last question before closing statements, and we're going to start with Mr. Russell. It's for both candidates. Do you believe Dr. Brewster went too far in pushing for COVID restrictions on our businesses? Do you believe Governor Hogan's orders to shut down businesses should have been ignored in St. Mary's County?
I believe we have to trust the officials we have in office to make the best decision that they have or that they can with the information available to protect the residents of our state and county. I understand where the frustration comes in when we're closing down businesses and our kids are outside of school and learning virtually. Trust me, my husband is a teacher, and watching him teach from home was as frustrating for him as it is or was for me. So I get it. But when we have evolving information that's changing daily, we trust the elected officials or officials that we have in place, even if they're not elected, to make the best decisions possible with the information they have at the time.
Commissioner Hugh?
I've said it before, I'll say it again. COVID fouled us all up. It was once, we've never seen anything like that. Millions of people died worldwide. Millions of people, over a million people died in the United States of America. So it was new territory. Now, Dr. Brewster, I'll use the term, did her job. She's a healthcare professional, and she did what she thought was best. Now, it was incumbent upon the commissioners to ask her the questions that we felt were necessary to be asked. Was she going too far? Did she have the science to support it? But it wasn't up to us to say these things shouldn't be or we should override her. Look, she did her job, and honestly, she did a great job, and I'm very appreciative. Now, Governor Hogan, we took our direction from the governor. As counties, we have to look to the state executive as to how we're going to do that, how we're going to move forward.
Okay, we're going to go ahead with the closing remarks. We're going to start with Mr. Russell.
Once again, I'd like to thank our hosts for this evening and everybody who is here in attendance and watching online for doing the work to get yourself educated before you cast your ballot in November or October if you do early voting. I want to bring a proactive, solution-oriented mindset to the Board of County Commissioners when I'm elected in November. We need to be on the ground listening to our residents, holding town halls, increasing the opportunity for people to provide feedback, whether that is in the town hall format or if we are hosting public forums. We shouldn't be having public forums at 9:30 in the morning, like there is one tomorrow morning. I'll be at work. We need to make sure we're accessible to our constituents. Once again, I want to do all of these things by focusing on my HELP program: healthcare, education, land use, and public safety. These four cornerstones of my campaign were crafted based on feedback I received from people like you when I was out on the campaign trail, and I'll continue to revise that as I receive more feedback. I'm responsive to the people who will elect me. I want to make sure we have healthcare access for our residents so they don't have to drive too far away. I want to make sure that our education system is strong, providing a good education for our students, that our educators feel valued and are paid what they're worth. I want to make sure that our land use is targeted, that we're recruiting the type of businesses to this area that we need so we don't have an overproliferation of things like vape shops or retail chain stores. I also want to make sure that our public safety is strong, that we have good recruitment and retention policies to encourage our public safety officers to stay in this county once they are hired here so they can live where they work and really learn about our community. Thank you again for being here. I hope to have your vote on November 8th.
Thank you very much. Can we go ahead and have the, Commissioner Hewitt.
Thank you, Katie. Katie, you do a great job, and thank you for all your help.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank all the people who have taken the time to come tonight in this nasty weather. Thank you for being here. I'd also like to thank the League of Women Voters, St. Mary's County Chapter of the NAACP, the Center for the Study of Democracy, and this St. Mary's County Library, St. Mary's County Lexington Park Library, for sponsoring tonight's event. There are many candidates running for many offices, state, local, and federal this year. And there will be many choices for the voters. And it's reasonable that there will be some confusion as to who you think can do the best job. I offer the voters of this county a strong background in running the county's business. And I have a deep understanding of county finances, land use policies, public education, critical area laws and regulations, and constituent services. It's important that you vote for someone with this experience, but also that you vote for someone who knows and understands St. Mary's County and its residents. Someone who knows the difference between Charlotte Hall and Ridge, between the 7th District and Valley League, between Lexington Park and Leonardtown. Someone who knows that while we are different in our interests, we are the same. And what makes us stronger is our differences. It doesn't divide us, it brings us together. Now, we have a wonderful county to live, to raise our families, and to pursue our dreams. What is really important and necessary is that we have the background and the experience to make that happen. I believe I'm that person. I've been there, I can do it, I can do it again. Thank you for coming, and God bless you.
District 4, Mr. Scott Ostro and Mr. Steve Tuttle. Now we'll have each candidate give their opening remarks. Mr. Ostro, we'll start with you.
Good evening. I'd like to start by thanking everybody for coming out today in this pretty nasty weather. I'd like to thank the Lexington Park Library, the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, and the Center for Democracy Studies for hosting this event. My name is Scott Ostro. My wife and I moved to this county 9 years ago, almost. It'll be 9 years coming up this November. We've made St. Mary's our home. It is a wonderful community. My wife and I had been out here on travel several times, and when my son went off into the Marine Corps, and my daughter went off to college, we knew we did not want to stay on the West Coast out in California, and we looked at each other and we asked, well, where do we want to go? Now's the time. And without hesitation, we both said, St. Mary's County. We have friends there. We love the area. It's beautiful. Why not look into moving there? Things happened very quickly for us, and it worked out very well. We were able to move out here, transfer our jobs. We met even more wonderful people. And what I like to refer to is, you know, you're born into your family, but here in St. Mary's County, we have family. We have very close friends that are as dear to us as family, and we were welcomed into this community with open arms. The reason I'm running for county commissioner is because I've lived my life as a life of giving service to others, and I wanted to continue that. I want to invest my time and my talents into making this great community that we live in an even better community. I believe that I have the skills to do so. I have a bachelor's degree in business management. I have a master's degree in business management and leadership. I've worked as a federal contractor for many, many years in purchasing and contracts. So I understand how to run a budget, how to run large budgets. I've worked on multi-million dollar contracts. I understand how to read a bottom line. I've been a small business owner in my past, so I understand the struggles of having to do that, having to pay your employees. Maybe sometimes you don't draw a check, but you pay your employees and you have to balance a checkbook and you have to decide what's important. My current job as a government contractor, as a purchasing manager and a contracting officer, is to make sure that taxpayer dollars are spent wisely and not wasted. It is my responsibility to ensure that I am a watchdog for taxpayer dollars, and I will carry that same zeal that I have for it and that same education that I have for it over into being a county commissioner. Thank you.
Thank you. Pardon me. Thank you. Mr. Tuttle?
Good evening. Thank you to the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, the Center for Democracy, and the St. Mary's County Library. My name is Steve Tuttle. If you didn't know that by now, I'm running for County Commissioner District 4, and I'm humbly asking for your vote. I moved to Maryland when I was 16, graduated from Arundel Senior High, class of 96, joined the Navy right after the 9/11 attacks, spent 11 years of service to the Navy. While I was stationed here from 2005 to 2008, I fell in love with the county. Did a short stint in Norfolk, and in 2012, I got out of the Navy, took a contract job right here at PAX, and moved back and married my husband and settled here for the last 10 years. I've been on several boards. I'm on the Animal Control Advisory Board. I've served on several HOAs that manage million-dollar funds and budgets. But my passion lies with being secretary, vice chair, and chair for Wrapping Arms Around Many, the emergency shelter program for the homeless during our winter months. That's where I learned where county works and it does not work. That's where I learned where our agencies and our county commissioners don't always mix well to take care of the needs of the community. So I decided to throw my hat in the ring. For the last 8 years, you haven't had a choice. It was just one person. I'm offering you that choice. I offer, as a veteran, I know how to navigate government and make government work for you. I don't trust 100% what our government does, and that's okay. But as a veteran, I can manage budgets. I don't take no for an answer, and I can navigate around that no to make sure that the needs of the people are met. And I'm here to listen to you. On the campaign trail, you have told me several times, our current administration is not listening to us. They're not hearing us, they're not responding to us, and when we do speak, they do the opposite on their decision. So again, my name is Steve Tuttle. Hear me out. I'm glad to take your questions this evening, and I'm so happy that you guys made your time today to hear me in this horrible weather. Thank you.
Thank you. Now to our first question. This question is for both candidates. Calvert County has a mental health court. It has been submitted as an idea to create one in St. Mary's with little support. There is a drug court and a juvenile drug courts, but nothing that addresses persons with mental health issues. They are treated as criminals in the current system. I'm sorry, I didn't see the question on that. I'm sorry. Would you like to respond to the statement? We'll start with Mr. Tuttle.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I was trying to find a question, guys.
So mental health is one of my passions, and I'm really concerned about it. We've talked about several things about putting a net around the bridge. Well, my concern is let's prevent people from getting to the bridge by offering them care and services that they need. Yes, I would support it. I would definitely like to do a community government partnership with a committee design and how we would set that up and implement it.
Thank you. Mr. Ostrom, same questions?
I also would definitely support that. In my work with the Tri-County Council, I also sit on the Tri-County Council Board, so I have a lot of experience working with other counties that surround us and making things work. So I would definitely get behind that. I would like to see further study on that. And I agree, we do have an issue with mental health in this area. So I definitely want to look into that, and I definitely want to see some improvements in that area, because it is a tragedy to see any life lost by taking that last horrible step. So anything I can do to intervene with that and help in that, I will definitely look into doing.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. What do you plan to do to help with job creation in the county to combat unemployment in the county? Mr. Ostro, you're up first.
Unemployment in the county is a very serious issue, and one that I take very seriously, that I have looked into extensively. We need to work with local businesses and partner with them. There, anywhere you go in this county, you cannot help but see help wanted signs. People are hiring all over the place. We need to develop programs and work with, I know there's several churches in the area that have programs such as Work to Life, where we're helping people who have maybe made some choices in their lives to where they're not eligible to work on the base, and they need a helping hand in getting resumes prepared and getting clothes to go on an interview and having those skills taught to them so they can go out and be successful in that. It's one thing to talk about it, but we need to put it into practice, and we need to get people into those programs so they can learn the skills needed to go out and get the many jobs that are out there.
Thank you.
So yes, I think the way we can do this is if we work with local businesses and contractors on the base, and we reinvest in our county with skilled labor. Not everyone is college material. I know I'm not. I'm a wrench turner, so college was out of the picture for me. But I make a good living on my talent and on my skill. And if we can focus at the young level in our high schools and keep investing in the tech center, but talking to these contractors and small businesses and seeing the skills that they're missing or they're lacking, and try to attract those or train individuals for those positions. And that was the way I would like to approach it.
Thank you. The next question is for Mr. Ostro. Your sign says lower taxes. What taxes do you want to lower? By how much? And what services do you plan to reduce or eliminate because of the tax revenue decreases?
I get this question very often. I firmly believe that we do not need to eliminate or cut services in order to lower taxes. Some of the taxes that I would like to see lowered is I would like to see the homestead tax lowered. I would like to see the income tax here, the county income tax lowered. I believe that we can do that. We can make a cut in that. There are several areas within county government that we need to look at. Not only in lowering taxes, that's one piece of it, but we need to look at county government as a whole. I come from a business background where you need to look at things from a Lean Six Sigma point of view. At the end of the day, the county is a business, so we need to look at it. We need to look at where we have redundancies within county government to be able to make those cuts to where it's not cutting services, but it's cutting where we might have duplicative effort. We need to look at that. We need to do a top-down review to ensure that our tax dollars can be better spent in other areas.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. Do you support the zoning ordinance to prohibit gas stations convenience stores, or liquor stores within 100 feet of a school, place of worship, or public park. And Mr. Tuttle, we'll start with you.
That's a good question. I don't know if I can give an educated answer on that. So I kind of like the idea, but I would really need to dig into the ordinance and get the language before I can make an educated answer on that.
Thank you. Mr. Ostro?
And I concur with Mr. Tuttle. I would have to look into that a lot more thoroughly. It depends on the business, the area. There's a lot of factors that go into that, so I would have to research that and to be able to give a proper answer to that.
Thank you. The next question is also for both candidates. What would you do to help the homelessness population in our county? And Mr. Ostro, you're going to go first.
The homeless issue in our county is a very serious one, and there is not an easy solution to it. I believe that we have to look into working with local industry, with local health care. A lot of the people that we have in this county that are homeless are struggling with a lot of issues. So we need to work with our county health and get people the help that they need. We need to also look into, it's been touched on several times, we need to look into affordable housing and find ways that we can do that. So it's a large issue. I wish there was a wand I could wave to fix it, but it's going to take a lot of work, and it's going to take some creativity, and it's going to take partnering. And that's what I do best. It's what I do for a living. I partner with businesses. I partner with people. I'm fully equipped to be able to do that to help solve these issues.
Thank you.
Well, this is a question that touches home personally for me, being part of WARM. There are community partnerships already available, WARM, the Mission, and the Health Department. But county government and our county commissioners have really kind of tossed that off to the side with our partnerships. They're like, that's their problem. Let them fix it up. But we're saving the county millions of dollars, and WARM runs off of 100% donations. We don't get any money from the county. The county needs to have a little skin in the game by communication and help us ascertain or achieve our goals with our community partners, with WARM, the Mission, in order for us to do our housing in the winter, and the Mission doing their day program and housing program. There are partnerships available. We just need to make that connection between county government and the partnership stronger, and the communication needs to go up and down and flow regularly and easily to identify the needs in the county. And then once we get identify the certain needs, we need to address them.
Thank you. This next question is again for both of you. Since both of you would be new to the office of commissioner, what is your background of service to St. Mary's County community? In particular, rather than just the federal government. Mr. Tuttle, you'll go first.
Well, with the WARM program is one. I serve on the Animal Control Advisory Board. I've been on there for the last year. So those are two things that I do for the county, and I do a lot of things behind the scenes that I'm not going to tell you about by helping people that are in need. I've taken phone calls from the sheriff's office at 3 or 4 in the morning for an individual we can't find housing for, and at times paid out of my pocket a hotel stay. But I don't want to brag about that because that's just the kind of person that I am. So I just lost my train of thought, sorry. Anyways, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Ms. Ostro?
Could you repeat the question, please?
Yes. Since both of you would be new to the office of commissioner, what is your background of service to St. Mary's County community in particular, rather than just the federal government?
My background in service to this county is, since my wife and I have lived here, I've been very involved through various men's ministries at our church. I am also very involved through various clubs that I belong to, Rotary Club and other clubs that we are very heavily involved in the community, doing community outreach. My further service to this county is that, I mentioned before, I sit on the Tri-County Council, which works with all the surrounding counties, our two surrounding counties, so I am used to working in conjunction with them to be able to solve problems, to be able to help the citizens of St. Mary's County. I also sit on the OPEB board, which oversees the county retirement fund for all county employees. So I work very closely with that. I feel that that's very important, and as well as numerous other, like I've stated, numerous other projects that I do work on.
Thank you. This next, pardon me. This next question is for Mr. Tuttle. Do you feel that the St. Mary's County residents are paying too little or too much taxes? Why?
That's a loaded question. Yes and no. I feel that we pay a lot in taxes in certain aspects. I feel we don't pay enough in other aspects. I feel that I don't mind paying more in taxes personally if I see the money coming back to the community and the reinvestment into the county is happening. I don't want to see it go to a fund balance and not come back to us. If we're going to have extra money, it needs to go back to the people with tax cuts or reinvestment in community projects. So that would be my answer.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. How can Lexington Park organizations and businesses communicate together to start a plan of revitalization? And we'll start with Mr. Tuttle.
Repeat the question, please.
Yes. How can Lexington Park organizations and businesses communicate together to start to plan revitalization?
Well, I mean, we need to start the partnership with county government and develop the boards that are communicating the needs of the community to the county commissioners and the county commissioners acting on that and actually listening and advocating for what needs to be done. And that's currently not happening.
Thank you.
Do you repeat the question again?
Absolutely. How can Lexington Park organizations and businesses communicate together to start planning, to start to plan revitalization?
I think the county could encourage a board of local businesses to get together so they can actually sit around a table and talk and discuss issues that they're facing and how they can collectively work to achieve the goals that they want to see. And I, for my district, very important for me, Lexington Park area. I want to see that area revitalized, and I want to see new businesses brought into that, and I want to encourage that however I can. If partnering with local businesses, I would be more than willing to sit on board that looked into those issues and supported those issues, because it is very important to me, and it is one of the things that I am running on and one of the things that we will see accomplished.
Thank you. This next question is for both candidates. Ms. Ostro, how do you plan to support volunteers, fire, and rescue squad?
That's a very important issue. I have gone around this county and spoken to individually to each fire and rescue squad. There are a lot of ways that we can encourage that. And I think before we immediately jump to making everybody a county employee and making all those paid positions, we need to look at ways to perhaps increase the LOSAP benefit and find ways of incentivizing people to bring volunteerism back. Let's be very clear. Our fire departments, volunteer fire, really is not an issue. Our main issue is with rescue, medical and rescue. So we need to look into that, perhaps working closer with the tech center, encouraging younger folks to come up through that program and to be involved. But I think a lot of it is finding ways to incentivize and finding ways to encourage people to want to volunteer.
Thank you. Mr. Tuttle?
I agree with Scott. The fire department's doing well. Our rescue squads right now are struggling, and I would really like to find ways to rebuild those volunteer pools up to pre-COVID standards. Now, I know there's a rumor going around about me that I want to move all EMS services to paid. That is absolutely not true. I do not want to do that. I want to reinvest in our volunteers. I want to keep the pools growing. But if we can't achieve those goals so that we don't have an hour-long 911 call, then we might have to continue with the county commissioners, which I've already started with the augmenting the hybrid program with paid employees. But I would like to rebuild our volunteer pools up to pre-COVID standards, if not better, so that we can eliminate adding more staff to county government.
Thank you. This next question is for Mr. Ostro. Mr. Tuttle talked about some of his community outreach activities. What types of community outreach activities have you participated in?
I believe I've already stated it, but I'm happy to state it again. I have worked very closely with the Rotary. I am out there whenever we have street cleanups anywhere in the county. I have been out for that. We just did one several months ago on Great Mills Road. We were out there. That was a county cleanup there. I'm involved in Rotary for other road cleanups. I worked with men's ministries through my church and supporting various issues throughout the county, mental health, struggles with homeless. I could go on and on, but time is short, but I am very involved in this community. My wife and I love this community, and anything that I can do to give back to this community, I would definitely do. And I also consider the boards that I sit on helping this community are also very important and community outreach.
Thank you. This next question, and unless I get some more questions, all will be for both. We're going to start with you, Mr. Tuttle. The commissioner who one of you will replace has been an opponent of the YMCA. Will you support it?
Yes, yes, and yes. The YMCA would be not only an economical development for the county, but it'll bring much needed love to an area that has been misjudged for far too long. Lexington Park needs a little love, and I think the YMCA is exactly the answer to that. And it gives our youth and some of our older people, like myself, something to do that benefits everybody. The YMCA benefits everybody, and the county only has to put up a one-time fee, and then that runs itself. No more tax dollars are involved in it. So for me, I think it's a win-win. Yes, I support the YMCA.
Thank you.
Well, not to be outdone by my worthy opponent, I say yes, 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 and yes. Once again, the Lexington Park area needs this. In my going around and door knocking and talking to people and individuals in this community, the one thing that people tell me resoundingly is there's nothing for the youth to do. So what choice do they have? They're going out and getting in trouble. An organization like the YMCA has been doing this for 160 some odd years. They know how to run these programs. They have structured programs for kids right after school. I think the location is a perfect location for it, right there by Great Mills High School, so these kids can get out of school and go over there and have structured programs, people who care. And again, it's a one-time cost for the county, and then it's run entirely by the YMCA. And I also want to see more than just one YMCA. I want one in the north end of the county and one further south.
Thank you. Mr. Offshore, you can stay standing. You're going to start off with this question.
Okay.
What do you see as the biggest roadblock for St. Mary's as a peninsula community versus a non-peninsula community?
That's a tough question. I think just that, it's a peninsula community, so we're a little isolated down here, so I think that is a bit of a roadblock for us, but I believe that we can work through that. My work with the Tri-County Council is one of those things where we are partnering with other counties, where we are able to get things accomplished corporately to where it benefits all counties, so I think that's very important. We tend to be very isolated down here in St. Mary's County, so we need to find ways to bridge that gap in order to bring more things into this county, and that's my answer.
Thank you.
Could you repeat the question, please?
Absolutely. What do you see as the biggest roadblock for St. Mary's as a peninsula community versus a non-peninsula community?
I think the biggest roadblock for us is that we have such a large environmental waterways that we need to protect. I think being isolated in a way could be a good thing. I mean, it's not always necessarily a bad thing. St. Mary's County is a beautiful rural area that has so many things to offer. But government and its people need to speak up when Annapolis needs to pay attention. It shouldn't be just the government speaking. It should be all of us speaking. And the government should be working for the people to advocate for the needs of the county once the people address the county, or to address the county commissioners on that need.
Thank you. And Mr. Tuttle, you can keep your microphone. Are you going to go next?
All right.
But the question is for both. Do you support critical race theory in our schools?
So that is such a broad statement. Do I support critical race theory? I'm going to tell you, no, I do not. But I do support the education of the true history of this country, the good, the bad, and the ugly, based on the grade level and the age appropriate. I don't know what critical race theory is being defined by the right. I can only imagine. So no, I don't support what they're saying critical race theory is, but I do support true education about our American history, no matter how ugly it is.
Thank you. Mr. Armstrong?
No. I do not support critical race theory being taught to our children. No, I don't. I think we need to be very careful. We need to make sure that we are working with our school board, that we are listening to parents, that we are hearing what they have to say when their kids come home. And we hear these stories of, you know, kids being taken into other rooms and asked all these ridiculous questions of what gender they want to be called by at the wrong ages. I firmly believe we need to make sure that we are keeping our education to writing, reading, arithmetic, and the true history. Again, no matter how ugly it is, it needs to be taught correctly and truthfully and honestly.
Thank you. And hold on to the microphone.
Hold on to the microphone.
That's right. What can be done to address the mental health in St. Mary's County?
Well, again, partnering with the health department of the county, working with Dr. Brewster. We just opened a health hub right in my district, right on Great Mills Road. I think that is fantastic. That is one huge step to being able to bring health care to this county. There are other plans in work to open additional similar health hubs in those critical areas. We need to definitely work with that. We need to be partnering with the folks at the Bean Center. We need to be partnering and encouraging other mental health practitioners to come into the county, finding ways that we can do that, and working through the private sector and encouraging that to happen.
Thank you.
Well, the first thing I'd like to do is to attract mental health specialists to the county, either with tax breaks or loan repayment programs. I would continue with the Sheriff's Office. Tim Cameron has started with the Sheriff's Crisis Response Team to go out and send professionals along with the police officers to deem if someone's in crisis, to give them the right help they need. And then I would also work with the Health Department with Dr. Bruce's Crisis Response Team, and the hub is going to be a crisis response center. So I would support all those. And that's just the beginning. And once we get those
paid for and going with either grants or loans, or hopefully a nice county resident will donate and get those off and going, then we can put other crisis response hubs throughout the county to fit the needs.
Thank you. Hold on to that microphone. Can you talk about your support of more affordable housing in St. Mary's? If you don't think it's an issue, why?
It's an issue. First, we need to define what affordable housing is, and we need to create that definition. Once we create a government community partnership and a board to sit down and go, what is affordable housing? This is what it is. Create the definition. Once we've created that definition, then we can work to build affordable housing for the county. I would also like us to see it as to change the ordinances for tiny homes. We don't really have anything going on those right now, and we cannot build a tiny home according to what my research, and I would like to see the ordinances change for that so that people want to build tiny homes on their property, they can.
Thank you.
Repeat the question, please.
Absolutely. Can you talk about your support of more affordable housing in St. Mary's? If you don't think it's an issue, why?
It is certainly an issue. I know firsthand. My daughter works on the base and makes a decent living for somebody out of college and working, and she has tried to buy a house here in this community, and she can't afford it. So it is definitely an issue, and again, there are different levels of affordable housing. So what's affordable for my daughter may not be affordable for somebody else. I think we need to broaden our perspective on that. We need to incorporate more affordable apartment buildings. We need to incorporate building more condominiums. We need to look at all different ways to encourage builders through tax breaks or incentives or things like that, to where a certain portion of the neighborhoods that they're building, that they are building some that are more affordable. So there's all kinds of ways to do it, and I believe that we can do it if we put our minds to it.
Thank you. Hold on to the mic. Do you think the sheriff's, state's attorney, and other court positions should be nonpartisan?
These are all elected positions. To run them as nonpartisan, I don't know. I really don't have an answer to that. They are elected officials. You can run as a nonpartisan in any one of these elections. But as voters, it is important that we be able to say, you know, I don't like what you're doing. I want to change that. We need a change. So we don't like what you're doing. We will vote a different way another time. So I think we all have our leanings one way or the other, Republican, Democrat. I think the most important thing to do is to elect the most qualified people for those positions.
Thank you. Tuttle?
Yes, they need to be independent of every of the two major parties. How can the scales of justice be blind if someone has an allegiance to a party, especially when it comes to a judge? And I would expect that from a state's attorney as well as the sheriff. So yeah, I would think they would be nonpartisan positions, but that's just my opinion. It's really the will of the county residents and what they want, and I have to abide by that because I'm not being your leader, I'm here to be your servant, and that's really what the county wants.
Thank you. And this will be our final question before closing remarks. What do you plan to help with safety and community in our schools? I don't think I said that right. Let me try one more time. What do you plan to help with safety in our community and schools? And Mr. Tuttle, I believe you're up.
Can you read it one more time?
Thank you.
What do you plan to help with safety in our community and schools? How are you going to keep our schools and communities safe?
All right, well, you have a Board of Education that you have elected, so that's going to take care of your schools, and whatever the Board of Education decides, I would back them up. I believe in SRO officers. I think they all need to be in our county schools, and it's a great asset for safety. I believe our sheriff's office has a rate we need to restock, or not, sorry, not restock, refill the vacancies that we have right now. I believe one of the ways to retain employees through the sheriff's office is to have them make a commitment. If the county's paying for them to go to the police academy, they should at least commit to us for at least 2 or 3 years. And then as our community, you know, our community, people paint Lexington Park and in District 4 and some sections that it's this horrible place. Is Lexington Park a little rough around the edges? Yes, it is. She needs a little love. And I think that if we work together, a government-community partnership, together, we can make Lexington Park better, and that's how we can make our community safer.
Thank you. So we landed on, how are you gonna keep our community and schools safe?
Once elected, it will be my job to make sure that we have a school board, okay? My job will be to ensure that the school board has the funding that they need in order to be able to make our schools safer and do the things that they need to do. So I will support that, as well as making sure that our sheriff's department has the funding that they need to be able to encourage more people to come work for them. We need to be making sure that we are offering competitive salaries. This is a beautiful community to live in, and I think we can encourage more people to move here, more people to join the law enforcement in this area, and we need to just make sure that we are perhaps requiring them, if we're putting them through the academy and things like that, to give us a commitment. And we can also look at ways to encourage them through perhaps maybe breaks in taxes if they're buying a home.
Thank you. So now we'll have our closing remarks, and Mr. Tuttle, you'll go first.
Well, first of all, thank you everybody for coming out tonight. Right now, sitting and listening to me and my opponent talk, there's not very much of a difference between us two, is there? What I do offer you is, once a year, I do the point in time where we count the homeless population in this county. I've been in the trenches. I've seen firsthand the homeless communities and the encampments that are in the woods behind these shopping centers that probably you guys don't even know about. So I'm humbly asking your vote because I'm willing to work for you. I don't have a fancy degree, but I have the skill and the training by being in the Navy to get the job done. If you have more questions, please go to my website, www.electtuttle.com. I humbly ask for your vote, and I hope that if elected, I can represent you in the true fashion that St. Mary's County has welcomed me and my husband. And again, thank you so much for coming out, and I thank the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, the St. Mary's County Library, and the Center Study for Democracy for putting this on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Once again, I would like to thank everybody for coming out in this weather. I'd like to thank the Lexington Park Library, the League of Women Voters, the NAACP, the Centers for Democracy Studies for hosting this event. I too am here to humbly ask for your support and your vote. I moved to this county 9 years ago. This county has become our forever home. We have laid down roots here. We were very blessed to have our children move here. When my son got out of the Marine Corps, they loved this area so much that they moved here. I have two grandchildren who are going to grow up in this community. My daughter, after she got out of college, also moved to this community. She will be raising her family eventually in this community. So I have a very large stake in making sure that this amazing community that we live in continues to be an amazing community for years to come, not just for my kids and grandkids, but for all of us. So I humbly ask you for your support and your vote, and I once again thank you all for coming out tonight and hearing what we have to say.
Thank you.
Now, can we have the candidates for County Commissioner District 1 please come to the table?
Sheila, can you hear me here? Can everyone ever hear me?
Yes, I can.
Can you hear me now, Sheila?
Now you're muted. Probably because you have the other thing on also. I hear like an echo when you talk, but I can hear you. Do you hear what I tell?
Very well. Very well.
Turn off the mic.
I need people to hear the mic too.
Just give a quick cut. Eric, talk to the other mic. Just the microphone thing. Okay.
No, it can't be that close.
Can you hear me now?
We're going to postpone the District 1 race to the 12th. So we will be done for the evening. And come back on the 12th. We'll do 29C, Commissioner President, Commissioner District 1, and Board of Ed District 1. And I would like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. And give a big thank you to the Lexington Park Library for their hardworking staff that made this evening possible. Now that you are the best type of voters, the educated type, be certain to vote either during early voting by mail or on November 8th. And we hope to see you all on the 12th.